Okay, back again. Pinball Hacker, gonna tell us more stories of changing trends in rock music and how Dolly Parton is memorable folks and new kind of rock star. Use Bar.
Can everybody hear me?
No.
You can't? Oh.
You can.
Okay. I don't like doing public speeches, so I apologize right now. And I apologize for everybody who thinks this is going to be a great talk, because it's probably not. I'm supposed to tell a funny story. Last year we were here, and we were doing a group of people who were home group pinball people. One of them was Jerry Stoltenberg from P3, one of them was Lynn Linoleum from Massachusetts, and myself, and we were sitting there talking, and he said, why did you do the OPP boys? Because, these little wing parts here that go on this processor, like, why did you do that? And I said, basically, I didn't want to pay the $50 to build the boards myself because it wasn't really worth it to me to pay $50 if other people weren't going to use those. And that's really how the whole OPP stuff started. I was basically, I knew that I was going to do the work myself, and spending the time doing the documentation so that other people can do the work, that actually takes most of the time. Talk's not on OPP. Today. The talk's actually going to be on just general pinball electronics and go through the world of where we started at in EM machines, go all the way through solid state, the MPs, essentially the same, and all the way to where, in the last 5 seconds, I'll probably talk about where I think pinball is moving. Okay. Oh. Hey, this is who am I? So I started fixing pinball machines 10, 15 years ago at this point. And as anybody who knows who starts in pinball, or at least how I started in pinball, the cheap machines out there are the EM machines. And so those are the ones that you can buy for a price that doesn't bankrupt you. And so that's what I really worked on the most. I created the Open Pinball Project because I wanted to build my own pinball machine. This was back in the Yaya days, 7, 8 years ago, where everybody wanted to start their own pinball company. So I'm like, hey, I'd like to build my own pinball machine. You know, everybody feels that they have a good pinball thing that they can do. Why should I try that? I was living up in Vermont at the time, so I fixed. The good part there was I actually got to work on all of his machines and fixed his machines for free. So that I could learn how all the electronics works. I got to work on a lot of DMP games using his stuff. Why he trusted me, I'll never know. But let's see. Then in 2015, we did Sharpshooter 3 because Roger Sharp was here, and I thought it was going to be a great inside joke to make a pinball machine after Roger Sharp. And then he showed up for Pintastic, and it was kind of awkward. So last year we did the OPP Kickstarter, the Open Pinball Project Kickstarter in 2016, so I didn't really get to do much. And this year I rethemed a Dolly Parton machine to a Van Halen machine, which is over in the free play area, which nobody can figure out how to select the person. Things that make sense in the home environment do not necessarily make sense in the freeway environment. So, EM machines. This is where I started because I could actually buy an EM machine for, you know, $150. It's pretty easy to find an EM machine that doesn't work, that is a player's machine, as they call it. But you learn a lot. Most use only AC voltage until at the very end of the EM era, they actually started converting the flippers to use DC voltage to give a little extra kick. And they mostly contain solenoid switch stacks, set reset relays, score reels, a score motor, and the up down count units. So let's see here. Oh, here's the back of the EM backbox. So the EM backbox, here you can see an up down counter. Those are the score reels there. This is another from here. You have your switch. Here you have your switch sets. So I'll throw this out so people can look at it. This is a solenoid with a switch stack. So you can do that.
It's so clean.
It's cleanish. It was probably in a bar where there was a lot of people smoking continuously. So that's a normal solenoid with switch stacks. Here's a picture of it, if you can't see that one right there. So here you have your solenoid here, and then you have your switch stack here. So when the solenoid, which is this guy, this coil of wire, gets energized, it actually pulls this piece of metal down, which is the spring resets it. It pulls it down, and then it switches between these two contacts. Here in the at rest state, it's making contact with the top one, and when the coil gets energized, it will make contact with the bottom one. So that's how an EM machine figures out. It's how it does, gives you points, it's how it does everything. That's, it's making connections when you're in a certain state. The machine knows what state you're in, and that's how it gives you points. So the solenoid de-energized, certain connections are made. When the solenoid is energized, different connections are made. The way that I approach fixing EM machines, and one of the easiest ways, is that you just have to make sure that when the coil is energized, different connections are made than when the coil is not energized. They didn't put any switches in there or any leaps in there to the switches that should not change state when you go between those two things. A lot of people who first start trying to fix EM machines, they get out their leaps. Hopefully they have a leaf switch tool, and they start mucking around with it, trying to adjust the gaps. Before you ever want to do that, you really want to first make sure the stack screws are tight. There's screws at the end of it. So it's these screws right over here. Those are the two screws. So over 30, 40, 50 years, it's probably 50 years now at this point, those will start to loosen themselves. When they loosen themselves, the adjustment for the switches go out. So if your switch stack is not tight, you will actually find out that, you'll go, oh, I need to adjust this one, when in reality, it's just because they're not tight. And if they aren't tight, you will never get repeatability in your switch stack. So what I do is I move between the rest and the energized positions to visually inspect the switches, verify that all the connections change or the leaps make things, and then make sure that the gaps are correct. It's, I think I said an eighth of an inch here. It's one of those things where you, with working on EM machines a long time, you just get used to this is what size the gap should be when I look at it. Adjusting the leaf strip, the stack leaf should be a last resort. That means going in there and using your leaf adjuster tool and bending it. Don't do that unless there are no other ways to do it. Because once you bend that, then to bend it back into position, if you work right, makes it that much more difficult. And the best eyes, the eyes are the best of lovers in EM machines. In an EM machine, you should be able to pretty much almost see anything that is wrong with it until you get to the sword wheels and stuff. But we'll talk about those in a second. There are a couple relays in there that are called set-reset relays. I didn't have a set relay that I could bring. So basically, what happens is a solenoid energizes and it goes to one position. And it actually clicks into that position so it can stay in that position without power being applied. Then there's a second relay, which is the reset relay. And when that one gets energized, then it moves it back to the initial position. These tend to be very important. They do things such as powering the flippers. If you find out that you have an EM game that almost nothing works on it, one thing that you should really look at is look at the set-reset relays. There will be three or four of them right underneath the playfield. There are many fewer of them than normal solenoids, and that's because they're more expensive, and so they didn't want to put as many of these in it. It takes two solenoids to do that. And when you're trying to figure out if they work or not, you same thing that you would do with the normal solenoid and the switch sets. Sword reels. Got a picture of the sword reel? Hey, here's the sword reel. Okay, so sword reel. This is usually there's a little catch that you just undo the catch and it pops out from the back of the thing. The important part in the sword reel is this mechanism right here. So this mechanism actually has three different positions. It has a position for when you are in the digits 1 through 9. Then at the 9 position, it says that the next time that it gets incremented, it has to increment the next score reel up in the line of score reels. And then there's also a connection that says, I'm at the 0. So if you sit here and move this solenoid with your hand, and make it click, you actually see this go into three different positions so that it can tell all of those different things. Score reels, how they work is a single pulse increments the digit. That's all it can really do. When a digit is 9, that piece of plastic makes it so another connection is made so that it increments the next digit in the line. The last one is a separate connection is made when the digit is 0. And that's important because the machine will not reset and start running until after it thinks that the score has been zeroed out. So a lot of the times you will go to buy an EM machine and you'll plug it in and all you hear is the score motor going cha-chunk, 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 cha-chunk. This morning, we heard that probably 20 times in the freeway area as the people's machines were trying to be brought up after being moved. Most of the time, that is indicative that the connection for telling whether the score is 0 or not isn't working properly. So when you're fixing these, you individually inspect the digits, verifying that the three positions work properly, and every time you see it move between the three positions, that you actually see different connections made. And yep, the score motor runs continuously. It's the most likely at the end of the day that you should look at the score reels themselves. Score motor. The score motor is the big motor that sits in the bottom of the EM pinball machine. It is very important because it allows multiple values to be added at once. So let's say when you hit a target that you get 500 points. An EM machine can't say, just add 5 to that. What an EM machine has to do is it says, okay, I'm going to run the score motor one single time. On the score motor, you will see notches in each of the reels, in each of the discs on the score motor. one of them will have five different notches in it. So as it goes around, it sends pulses, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and then at the end, it will be back at the starting position again. So all it really is able to do is say, okay, run the score reel once, and then when it runs the score reel, the score motor once, it simply, that sends five succinct pulses to one of the digits, and that will increment the value there. So each of the disks on the notches can have different numbers. So sometimes if you want to be able to score 300 points, then it would have three notches on it, five notches. The other thing that the score motor is very used frequently in is when it's trying to count your bonus. So if you get 500 points for each of the lights that you've lit on the thing, it will first count 500 points to the first light, and then it will actually use one of the set reset counters to decrement it by one, and then run the motor again for 500 more again. So a lot of the EM machines, you'll hear it go, you know, cha-chunk, and then you'll hear ching-ching, cha-ching, 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 and then it will move to the next one. So that's actually how that works. Up and down count units.
Do I have a picture of this?
Yes. Okay. So for up and down count units, they come in a couple different flavors. This one, you know, it can count up, it can count down. One solenoid is used to make it count up. The second solenoid is used to count down. There's also some of these that instead of counting one at a time, it basically has an up count, and the second solenoid is used to reset the whole thing. So you'll when it moves that one, it will go chink, 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 and then if it uses the other solenoid, it will actually reset the whole thing because there's a spring in the center of it that makes it go back the other way. Uses wipers to make different connections. So here, instead of leaves. Can you see it here?
No, it's on the other side.
So some of these, which I don't have a picture of evidently, so they have wipers that sit on the baked light disc. So the baked light disc is this thing. And they have metal wipers that sit there. And as the unit counts up, it slowly rotates, and those make different connections. As the unit counts down, same thing, the rotation. One important way that works is they use an up count, down count unit to do things like if you have multiple players. So when you go to the second player, you want it to increment the second player's score as opposed to the first player's score. To do that, it rotates the disc to one thing, and it says, you know, maybe it has three balls or five balls, rotates it to the other one. So now instead of the pulses going to the first set of score reels, it will go to the second set of score reels. So that is how it actually switches between having, you know, counting score for player one or counting score for player two. Uses wipers to make different connections, can have a single solenoid to only count up. The single solenoid ones to count up, things such as the bonus. The mash. Score reels, yep. So the mash is done every time you hit anything, it just goes up. And then at the end it says, oh, have you mashed on this digit? Yes? Okay, you get a free game. Now two solenoids, count down, we talked about the reset. Pretty much every EM machine I have ever bought in my life, I've had to disassemble and clean these things. It just seems that, I mean, if they're sitting in all the things that I buy, they always tend to be sitting in somebody's garage or somebody's barn. And so I use isopropyl alcohol, take everything apart, and clean it very well. you will many times think to yourself, well, the string isn't strong enough because it's old, and therefore since it's old, the string must be, it's never the spring. Usually that's indicative that there's dirt in there, so it can't rotate as cleanly as it should be able to rotate. The other option is that sometimes people decide that WD-40 is a great lubricant that they should use, and after 20 years it becomes not a very good lubricant, and that means, once again, take it apart and do it. When you take it apart, just take lots of pictures and clean it up with isopropyl alcohol and put it back together, and 90% of the time it will work perfectly.
So the other 10 parts left. And bushings, never any bearings, right?
Never any bearings. All this stuff was easy, made, beautiful. It is just rock solid, works.
Can you talk about when to apply lubricant, what style, and when not to apply lubricant in these situations? Because you have metal to metal, you have metal to plastic, and you have plastic to plastic situations.
My personal feeling, which may be wrong, is I never put lubricant on anything in a pinball machine.
Wow.
Ever. But there are people that, Richard, what do you think?
WD, I don't think anyone understands. WD represents water displacement.
Yeah.
In other words, the moisture was never intended as a lubricant. There's dry forms of graphite you can use. If it's plastic and metal, I would steer away from any type of lubrication. If it's metal and bronze bushing, probably synthetic lube, small amount that they use for brake calipers, for brakes. It's synthetic, it's high temperature, not that you're gonna need it. But the other aspect is using WD, highly flammable, and if you get any sparks that are happening, you're gonna wind up having a fire.
EM machines always have sparks.
Yes, they do.
The manufacturers on EM days would say it's okay to coil in the square motor, rotating parts, metal rotating against metal, and using stuff called Hoover plate, maybe on the edge of the cam, the square motor cams that have override on it. They're generally advising against wipe your fingers, wiping on the disc.
Yep.
Oil is an insulator. So you get oil on the fingers, not an insulator, huh?
Yeah. So that's another thing. A lot of times, I'll pick up an EM machine, and the EM machine doesn't work very well. And I'll just sit there and hit the targets and make sure that you actually get a spark every time you hit a target, and that will end up acting as will burn off any oil that's been sitting on there for years and years and years. And by doing that, this is a slide coming up, but basically, all of that, doing things like that, you're not doing anything that is modifying it. So you, at least, are not going to hurt the machine to a point. As soon as you get out a file and start filing on things, you know, you're now modifying the machine and you can't go back.
Some of the coatings that are on the contact point, the tungsten, when you start removing that, it's going to start arcing. Like the old automotive carbons, you may wind up arcing out those points to where I'm not going to burn one from the other.
Actually, that's actually a really good